Welcome to Catching the Light, your daily Bible study. Join us as we discuss God's unchanging truth and show how it can be applied in our day-to-day lives. And now, here's your host, Kip Bradford, on Catching the Light.
Hello, and welcome to this special episode of Catching the Light. As you can tell, Kip is not here today, but we are going to have an exciting and wonderful episode today, and I hope you really enjoy it too. I'd like to introduce our guests today. We have Karen Byrd. You've been here before. Mm-hmm. You helped us with one of our Christmas episodes.
Yes, yes.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
And you brought somebody with you today, somebody special. You want to tell us who you brought?
This is my husband, Charles Byrd.
Welcome, Pastor Byrd. You're also pastoring which churches?
I pastor the Grants Pass Church here, and also I pastor a church in Cave Junction.
All right. Welcome. We're so glad you're with us today. Thank you. And we have a very special topic that I'm excited about, mm-hmm. and I think you guys must be too, judging from all you've brought. So, Karen, would you open us with prayer, please, and then we'll dive in.
Heavenly Father, we're just so grateful that you have given us your word and you have guided us with your Holy Spirit. And today as we contemplate a portion of your scriptures, we pray that your Spirit will be here with your presence and with your truth. This I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
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 So, Pastor, you were just saying that it's getting to be a certain time of year, and it's getting close to what we call here in America, Easter. Although Neto, who originally is from Brazil, tells me that in Brazil, they don't call the holiday Easter. They call it Passover.
Which is where it originally came from. And unfortunately, because of the way we've set that date on our calendar, it doesn't exactly match the real Passover. But nonetheless, this is actually about Passover.
That's right. And that's what we're going to be digging into today. Mm-hmm. So I'm really excited about this. So let's start. Karen, would you start us off? We're going to look at the story first and then dig a little deeper into it.
Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, "This month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, 'On the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb, according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons. According to each man's need, you shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight."
Pastor, you want to tell us what's happening here in today's terms?
Well, Passover was just about to start, the very first one ever, and it had to do with the deliverance of the children of Israel out of Egypt. They had been in bondage now for a couple hundred years. A new Pharaoh was on the throne, and they had been in bondage. Now Moses gets sent back, and he says, "Let my people go." So they're going to do that. They're about to get let go. There's been all these plagues that have fallen on Egypt, and now they're about to get released. And so he's setting them up for the very first Passover. And part of that was you have a lamb, you sprinkle the door blood on the doorpost, the Passover angel passes over. So they're getting ready for that whole deliverance.
And at this time, they did not have a priesthood or anything like that. So it was the head of the household that was acting as the priest for their family.
Their family, yes. And yeah. I think it's beautiful how in verse 4, the Lord commands Moses to say, if the household is too small for one lamb, if one lamb is going to be too much for you guys, share it. It's okay. You can combine two households for this meal. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And to me, the beauty of that is that there is nothing too small for God to notice.
Mm. Yeah.
There's no detail that in any way concerns our peace of mind that is too small for him to take note of and provide for.
Mm-hmm. One of the reasons, too, was that the lamb was supposed to be completely eaten up that night.
Yes.
It wasn't like there was going to be leftovers because there was not to be any kind of decomposing of
right.
it. And because Christ did not have any contamination in the tomb either. He was raised before he any of that started taking place. So
that's
I just
right.
thought that was an interesting correlation.
Yes, absolutely.
Now in this, he's actually setting them up to begin to see the plan of salvation as well.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because there's an ultimate thing going on here, and that is the Lamb of God, Jesus, who's going to come. So he's setting them up with all the symbols, and there's a number of symbols through here, and he's getting them ready. And actually, if we look into this, he's trying to get our hearts ready for the ultimate salvation when we get out of this world completely. We get to go to the heavenly mm-hmm. Canaan. We get to go home to be with God. So,
yes, and that's definitely something we're all looking forward to. But let's look at the next couple verses and see what happens once they have chosen this lamb, this perfect lamb. Let's pick it up in verse 7. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it. Then they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire, with unleavened bread and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Do not eat it raw, nor boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire, its head with its legs and its entrails. You shall let none of it remain until morning, and what remains of it until morning you shall burn with fire. And thus you shall eat it, with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. So he's giving a recipe, sort of.
Yeah.
And he's telling them exactly how to prepare this, because the symbolism was important. And we're going to come back to those points, those finer details. But he's giving some very specific instructions. And he ends with saying, you need to be ready to leave. Mm-hmm. You need to eat it in haste. Because you're going to go.
This was the night before they left.
That's right.
Yeah.
And the night before you move, you don't get much sleep unless you're the child.
Yeah, you're all packed.
There's always something that still needs to happen,
sure.
still needs to be cleaned, still needs to be taken care of.
Another thing I thought was interesting, too, is apparently in the reading that I did, sacrifices up to then typically were boiled. But in order to boil
oh.
a sacrifice, you have to kind of cut it up, you know, into pieces that can fit into a pot.
Mm-hmm.
But this was supposed to remain whole.
That's right.
Unbroken. Should be some symbolism
oh,
there.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
But roasted whole, like it says, with its, you know, its head and its legs, entrails, everything was to
just
be roasted
it.
Whole. Yep. Yeah.
And something special was to be done with the blood.
Blood was supposed to be taken and put on the doorposts, the two uprights, and the lintel, the piece going across. And of course, the 2 points, the 3 points of that actually symbolize the wounds of Christ and the cross. And, mm-hmm. you know, you see the blood there doing what the blood did on Calvary.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes. And can you imagine being a child and watching your dad do that?
Mm-hmm.
Watching this lamb that you had helped take care of, probably, at least the first, you know, the days right leading up to it, and then slaughtering it, and as mom is fixing it, dad is painting the blood.
And that blood, if you're the firstborn, is of special interest to you.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
Because it was, yeah.
And we're going to see it in the next
yes.
couple verses. Pastor, would you read those, please?
For I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night, and will strike all the firstborn of the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt.
Now, I'm my mom's oldest. So this story has always hit mm-hmm. me hard.
A little extra significance there.
A little yes. extra significance, yes. Because I always, whenever I would read this, I would put myself in the place of the firstborn. That's
mm-hmm.
where I was.
Sure.
And I can just picture a child, the firstborn, saying, Daddy, did you paint it dark enough?
Yeah. I want to be under the blood.
I want to be under the blood, and I want to make sure mm-hmm. that God will see it.
Mm-hmm.
Needs to be thick, needs to be dark, needs to be a big splotch.
Yeah.
Because I don't want him missing it.
True. You know, one thing about this verse I thought was kind of interesting where it says, and against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. It's mm-hmm. like, this doesn't seem to be talking about gods. It's talking about the firstborn. But a little study, I found out that the sacred bull Apis is a firstborn animal. So one of their sacred cows, one of their sacred bulls. They had sacred cows as well, cows and snakes and crocodiles. And
we still have sacred cows today.
Yeah. Anyway, but that was, so in a sense, mm-hmm. he was passing judgment on the gods of their of Egypt.
That's
because
right.
Because all the bulls that represented Apis would have been killed because they were all, it is a firstborn animal.
That's right.
So they had deitized a lot of these animals mm-hmm. and, you know, their deities.
Including the monarch
killed.
On the throne, mm-hmm. who was technically the firstborn, and then his son, which was now under penalty of the death angel, his son would have been in jeopardy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, leading up to this has been the plagues.
Right.
And so in each of those, the Lord has been attacking another of their deities. There was, mm-hmm. you know, the Nile.
True. Yeah.
Was considered a god. Well, each plague targeted a specific deity yeah. in the Egyptian grouping. And this was no different. Mm-hmm. Well, we are at our breaking point now. Stay tuned. We're going to be back in just a minute to flesh this out some more.
Thank you for listening to Catching the Light. We pray you're being blessed and encourage you to contact us with your questions and comments. You can reach us by email at radio@betterlifetv.tv. That's radio@betterlifetv.tv. Or visit us at betterlifetv.tv/catchingthelight. That's betterlifetv.tv/catchingthelight. Or simply call us at 541-474-3089. It's our sincere desire that you'll be blessed while studying the Word of God with us here on Catching the Light. Catching the Light is listener supported. To become a financial partner, visit our website or write to us at P.O. Box 766, Grants Pass, Oregon 97528. That's P.O. Box 766, Grants Pass, Oregon, 97528.
Welcome back to this special Easter Passover episode of Catching the Light. We have just looked at the story in Exodus 12, verses 1 through 13, the story of the first Passover, and God's directions through Moses to the people of Israel as to what they were to do to prepare for this life-changing night. Mm-hmm. And we have had some interesting discussion already. We have more to come. So we'll summarize by saying it happened like the Lord said it would. The death angel came through. And those families that had the blood on the doorpost and the lintels, they were safe. And that night, when the death angel came through, the Egyptians decided, we're done. Get out. Get out of here. Mm-hmm. And Israel left on their journey to the promised land. And it was a very memorable event. And the Lord was determined that it was going to remain in the memory of the people. Yeah. And so we see, starting in verse 16, that the Lord has some more specific directions.
So this day shall be to you a memorial, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it as a feast by an everlasting ordinance. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. On the first day you shall remove leaven from your houses. For whoever eats leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from Israel. On the first day there shall be a holy convocation, and on the seventh day there shall be a holy convocation for you. No manner of work shall be done on them, but that which everyone must eat, that only may be prepared by you.
So for a whole week, they were supposed to get rid of leaven.
Celebrate,
yes.
Without leaven.
So is that leftovers?
No, leaven is the yeasting agent. Whatever they use to make yeast, whether it's a sourdough or whether it's an actual yeast in your bread, but it's that the thing that makes bread rise.
Yeah,
yes.
It produces fermentation.
Natural fermentation.
So in the original Passover events, they were making their bread to carry with them and to travel. And so they weren't putting yeast in the bread dough because it would take time to rise before they could bake it. They needed to put the stuff together and bake it. And then two, if it had yeast in it, it might spoil faster.
Right.
And so in the original exodus of Egypt, from Egypt, their bread could not contain leaven because they had to move too quick.
Mm-hmm.
And that's to continue in this, not the whole year, but in this
during this week
celebration, during this week.
But it was brought in as a week because he wanted them not to just, you know, spend a few minutes and celebrate. He wanted them to think about this for a while and talk about it and remember it and sing songs about it. And yeah, it was a kind of fast.
Yeah.
And you think about it, it was a celebration of the power of God to deliver mm-hmm. from bondage and to see the blood in Passover, to save life, to preserve his people. And if that's not reason to celebrate, then we don't have one.
The thing that strikes me about this is there's a left and a right foot on this. There's a balancing agent. The one is there had to be absolute obedience. Mm-hmm. Now, the obedience wasn't some odorous, heinous thing that they had to lift this heavy load that it couldn't be lifted. It was kill a lamb. They could do that. Sprinkle the blood on the doorpost and the lintel. They could do that. It was totally easy to do. They could get it done. But if they didn't do it, the death angel would bring death to the firstborn in that family. So it wasn't just optional. And then when they were to eat, it said that they were to eat with their standing up, with their loins girt, like I'm ready to go for a walk. And for those of us who don't live in a dress society, and today we don't, but I've lived in a dress society where men wear a long flowing garb. And if you want to run, you can't unless you hike it up a little bit, gird it about.
You put know, it in it. Your, tuck it in your girdle.
So yeah, you need a belt, a girdle.
Yeah, exactly. So you pull it up. So in other words, we're going on a trip. We're getting ready. We're going now. Be ready. So there's a cry in that for us to be ready and then to cooperate with the God of redemption. Say, and he just had sent 10 plagues on Egypt. He showed that he was God. He showed that he could pull it off. He showed that he could get the job done. Now do what he says. And really, that's what it comes down to in our personal life. If we want to go to the heavenly Canaan, we need to cooperate. We need to let him be on the throne. We need to let him be God and get under the blood of Jesus Christ. Every day, spend that time in the Word saying, Lord, you got to cover me. You got to cover me. I have no righteousness. I have no goodness to offer. But we have to do that. If we say, oh, well, you know, standing up is too much trouble. Let's get some lounge chairs in here. Let's have some chairs made for this event where we can just lay around and make it really easy. And no, that would have been missing the whole point. It wasn't your comfort. It was, we're getting out of here.
Mm-hmm. You know, there's lives at stake, and you do what you need to do to get it done. And nobody resents that when it's a life and death situation. When we keep that in mind, it makes perfect sense. It's not about my comfort. It's about my salvation.
Mm-hmm. And it wasn't just a small little thing, but it was not typical for them to wear shoes in the house. So,
right.
You know, that other little feature was added by God, just a tiny thing, but it was a part of the whole big picture.
That's right. Be completely ready because I'm going to move and I want you along.
That's right.
Part of that last movement was judgment. He says, I'm going to bring judgment upon the Egyptians, upon their gods, upon this upon this life of living for self.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to bring judgment on that. And that's the last message in Revelation 14 given to a lost and dying world. The angel flies in the midst of heaven. The hour of his judgment has come. And so we don't really have time either now in these last moments of Earth's history. God's still on a rescue mission. Plagues are falling more and more than they've ever fallen before. There's more floods. There's more tornadoes. There's more earthquakes. There's more of everything. God is saying, I'm coming. I'm coming. Yeah, Lord, but I got to watch TV tonight. Yeah, Lord, I got to build this newer, better house, this newer, better business. Instead of saying, no, I want, Lord, to help you help others to be ready for that great exodus to the heavenly Canaan.
Yes. Absolutely. So let's look at some of these symbols, some of these details a little more closely. One of the obvious details, points in this symbolism is the lamb.
Mm-hmm.
We read about that in the very beginning. He made a point of detailing how they were to pick out this lamb in verse 5 particularly. Who did the lamb represent?
John the Baptist said it, "Behold, the Lamb of God, he takes away the sins of the world."
That's right.
And also it represented, it stood in place of the first firstborn male of the family.
Mm-hmm.
So it stood in place of that too.
It was the replacement, mm-hmm. the one who would take the
propitiation.
Punishment. Yes. That's the word.
Yes.
The propitiation, yes.
The one who takes the place of. And you know, for anyone who's ever had someone cover for you, you blew it, you knew you blew it, and somebody takes your punishment or says, "It's okay, I'll cover that." What a relief, you know, and Jesus is that for us.
That's right. And his blood covers.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think what's interesting is that when you start with the book of Genesis, the prophecies about the Messiah are very vague. We see through a glass darkly. And then prophecies keep coming and they keep coming and they keep coming. Well, this was a prophecy when they struck the blood on the doorpost and on the lintel. When they did that, I don't think that they knew about the cross. But when you look back through the cross,
sure.
and you filter everything to the cross, it's clearly there.
Yeah.
It's clear there. It's like, as God says, this is what's coming.
Yeah.
This is what's coming.
So, Karen, I noticed that you had several notes on your paper there. Is there anything else that you've found that you'd like to add?
I just thought it was interesting that it was supposed to be done at twilight, and there's some discussion amongst scholars of when that actually was. The meaning actually meant between the two evenings, and if you go with what some of the scholars are have felt was happening, the first evening or the beginning of the evening was when the sun kind of was just really showing that it was going down from the zenith, I guess they say. And then the second evening was when it actually set. And that was like between 3 o'clock and sunset. And so they were somewhere in between there, which is kind of interesting because that's when Christ died. Mm. It was, you know, around 3 o'clock. Mm. And that was when they were supposed to that was about the time they were supposed to slay the lamb. So I thought that was very fascinating.
That is neat. Well, let's move on now to the unleavened bread. The fact that leaven was the rising agent, the yeast, as we often refer to it.
Mm-hmm.
But what did that symbolize, and why did they have to get rid of it out of their dwelling places? Not just out of their food. They couldn't just avoid eating it. They had to completely clean house of it for an entire week. Why? What was in the symbol?
That represented the sin.
Yeah,
yes.
I would have to say, yeah, the symbol of impurity and moral corruption, and they weren't even supposed to have it around them. Yeah.
What was interesting to me was when Jesus said, "Take, eat. This is my bread. This is my body broken for you." So he was symbolizing himself in the bread, and then you read in the New Testament, he says he was tempted in all points like we are, yet without sin.
Mm.
And so again, another symbolism of Jesus. Our adequacy, our completeness, our nourishment.
Yes. I think we all have some yeast in our lives that we need to get rid of as we're preparing for the final rescue mission.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes, you know, it might be in our dwelling, but we say, well, we're not doing anything with it. It's just there.
We haven't put it in our food today.
Yeah. But this is kind of an example of completely purge your lives of this.
Jesus said in John 15:14, he said, "You're my friends if you do what I say." And I see in this story of the Exodus, no middle ground. It's either you're all in or you're not all in.
Yeah.
And so the question is today, are we all in? Are we going to cooperate with Jesus?
Yeah, that is it. All right, let's take a look at one last symbol. Let's look at the blood on the lintel.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a certain aspect of Christ. We already established that the lamb represented Christ. So this lamb's blood on the doorposts and lintel, what part of Christ's sacrifice was especially illustrated by that?
The blood is the life, mm-hmm. and it's also atonement, and it's very sacred in that way. And the fact that it was used with hyssop, which was interesting, on the doorpost and lintel, hyssop in the Bible is only used for purification purposes. And, you know, David saying, purify me with hyssop or something like that.
Yes. Yeah.
So it's that using the atonement, the blood with the hyssop, you know, cleansing us and purifying us, being under the blood.
That's right. And in order to get enough blood to put on the doorposts and the lintel, they weren't like, you couldn't just prick your finger and have enough. Mm-hmm. The lamb had to die.
Mm-hmm.
It took all of it.
Yeah,
and Christ was going to have to die. There was no other way to save me or anybody
That's
else.
Right.
There was no other way but the complete sacrifice.
Yeah.
And to do that with the hyssop, you're actually making the sign of the cross. You're reaching down into the bowl. You're going all the way up and putting the blood on the lintel. You're going down and you're dipping it and you're putting it on this side, down and putting it on that side. It's so Jesus is our sacrifice. He's our blood. And the reason that's significant is because the wages of sin is death.
Mm-hmm.
And there is no life once we've sinned. And Jesus had to step into our place and say, I'll take that punishment. I'll take that place. I will die in their behalf. That way I can be both just and the justifier.
Yes. What a beautiful picture we see in this Passover, the original story, and in the memorial of it. And so often in today's Easter celebrations, we forget. You know, they focus on the death of Christ and the resurrection of Christ, which we definitely need to.
But there's more there.
But there's so many more layers to that story.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, you have the whole secular part of the celebration, which we're not even going to go into because that has no bearing whatsoever on the actual meaning of Passover. But I want to challenge myself and our viewers. Each time this time of year comes around, let's remember the backstory as well, because there's so much richness. And it's a story of a rescue mission, and that rescue mission is about to be completed for eternity. There's so many lessons for us here, so many things I've learned just in our conversation that I need to do a thorough cleansing. I need the Lord to do a thorough cleansing so that I'll be ready to walk out with him.
Mm-hmm. Which is why he wanted us to have, you know, why he had them do it yearly, to rethink it, refocus on it. Not let the cares of this world, you know, erode that away.
Yeah, it's too important to forget. But thank you all for joining us, and thank you for helping us to have a richer understanding of Passover. Thank you for joining us, and we will see you next time here on Catching the Light.